The burden of restraint. Gathering allies, though innumerable, were the wars and campaigns of conquest conducted by the Vulcan regime. Such constant antagonism would be futile if he wished to unite and make prosperous his new imperium. Born upon Vulcan, he and his salamanders knew all too well the values and limitations of empathy, and were almost as eager to forge alliances and treaties with those divergent realms they encountered as they were to defeat and occupy them. Some, such as Grand Sicarium and the affiliate Talons, did not wish to join with Vulcan's project, while others, such as the monstrous Chaos Imperiums, or the vile Tenabrian contingent, were too repellent and evil to parley with, and could only ever be enemies. However, not every rival power was such. In the middle decades of M53, the Empire of Vulcan was a vast and glorious thing, perhaps a golden age. The Promethean lodges on Armageddon collected and deciphered more and more captured technologies from colonized worlds. The shipyards of the 15,000 world empire were in constant use, as were the commandery world. Artwork and architecture was at its height, and every city and every world were strong and somberly beautiful places, as glorious as only the master artisan Primarch could make them. Every year, word would reach the civilized interior worlds of new members of their imperium, and there was rejoicing. Warp travel remained ponderous in the continued absence of the Astronomicon, but Vulcan had already begun a project upon the world of Venlake to attempt to create a form of psychic beacon. Though the projects ended in failure and the Year of Nightmares 7 years later, the fact he was confident enough to attempt this project while still at war demonstrated how secure and entrenched the Vulcan Imperium had become. There were several empires of note that were brought into the fold relatively peacefully. The so-called Risen Catalchon Oath worlds were a cluster of 6 dozen systems in the local sector directly around the 2 main worlds. They were relatively easy to bribe and coerce into the fold. The Risen Tech Priests were bribed with Architech and a promise to allow their Forge World New Sphere to link up with the new spheres of other liberated Forge Worlds, allowing them to share data. The Catalchon side of the Alliance merely joined because they saw little difference between working alone with the Tech Priests, or with the Black Giants folk. They just liked warfare. The Confederation of Justice was harder to convince. They were the remnants of the Elysian, Heraconian Varsine drop troops, who over the millennia had morphed into an elite band of peacekeeping thugs in the southern Segmentum Solar region, attacking worlds and shipping at random on the assumption they had subversive elements amongst their populations. When Vulcan soldiers eventually encountered these men in battle, it was through ambush. The world of Kaniar was in the process of being brought into the Imperium through the signing of a treaty at their capital. Clerks from one of the many councils of Armageddon had arrived on the war-battered world, guarded by 2 companies of the Commandery of the Dawn Revenants, in their burnished warplate. Halfway through proceedings, the warships of the Confederates arrived and declared the Vulcans traitors to the original Terran Imperium, and attacked the Revenant fleet. The Confederates were outnumbered and their ships were undergunned, and Vulcan's troops easily routed the fleet. However, their ships were converted to carry large troop transport facilities, and they swiftly deployed their drop troops onto the world before they retreated. The battle raged for weeks, and the skilled mortal soldiers, despite being attacked by the PDF of Kaniar and the might of Mark Iastarts, they held their own. Cal, the commander of the Dawn Revenants, was quoted as saying, "Determined as fists. Damn them. But you cannot help but admire their conviction." Eventually their forces were surrounded and captured. They surrendered honorably, and congratulated the Revenants for their well-earned victory, which unsurprisingly took the Astartes aback somewhat, for they were rarely praised by their foes. After questioning, the prisoners would not give up their home world, claiming every world that needs us is our home, for home is where the honor is. As it transpired, Promethean cultists with the fleet managed to track the warp trails of the retreating fleet, though they were masked well, and found the location of their base of operations, a vast Ramillies-class star fort, which had become clad with additional living quarters and blister-like biodomes that made the space station look like a vast shanty town. Cal and his negotiators managed to gain an audience with the Muster Lord of the Confederated Drop Troopers, who listened to their proposals, and peruse the files given to him that proven the Vulcan Imperium was a worthy successor to the Terran Imperium, which had fallen long ago. The Muster Lord listened and took it all in with patience and good grace, before calmly pointing out that his men had discreetly infiltrated the Vulcan ships, and had taken over the engineering sections and gun batteries. Elite assault boat teams had stormed the ships, and the prisoners held in the vessels had rigged an explosive from inside their cells, and had blown themselves free, before coming to the aid of the strike teams. The Muster Lord, after informing Cal of this fact, then requested that the Revenant surrender. Cal snarled, explaining that his men could rip apart his paltry boarding forces and retake the ships within half an hour. The Confederate Lord then countered by explaining simply, that is half an hour without motive power or guns, while being within range of the full firepower of a star fort. I hope your men could retake the vessels in less than half an hour, otherwise your vessels will be scrap. I humbly request, therefore, that you surrender, and save us having to slay brave astarts. Cal had little choice other than to surrender to the mortal general. Word reached Vulcan of this setback, and he deployed two battle fleets to the area, to locate and free his men, before destroying the enemy. In the year it took for this force to be assembled and deployed, Cal and his men were imprisoned, and learned of the culture of their foes. They were not degenerates or villains, but merely broken soldiers, desperate for a central command and a reason to fight on. Everywhere they looked over the millennia had been horror and war. The Ophelians were murderers and maniacs, and their worlds burned with hate and misery. Space Marines rampaged and laughed as they torched worlds at random. Demons and twisted Xenos fiends capered and spread their malice across countless worlds. The Confederacy had looked upon the Vulcan Imperium, and they refused to believe that such a realm could exist in such a galaxy of horror. Cal explained it was so, but it was only once his men had broken free of the prisons and had efficiently taken over the starfort by force, that the Muster Lord reluctantly heeded his words. When Vulcan's twin fleets tracked the starfort down amidst the swirling eddies of the warp lanes, they found that Cal's men had made an ally of the troopers, who eagerly pledged oath to the new Imperium, and sent delegates to Armageddon for formal training and establishment of their official regiments. In exchange, clocks and administrators were brought to the fleets of the drop troopers, to help them organize their new territories. The planets that they had madly protected against all comers for centuries, became their official domain. Vulcan himself parleyed with the leader of the world of Seki, a world of shadowy smog and blazing lava canals and plasma pits that fueled its sparse industry. The world was almost useless in almost every way. However, the world was a known hub and control center for the Order of Heracles. This order was a group of fearsomely competent assassins and spies that bore the heritage of the once infamous Officio Assassinatorium. Vulcan met with veiled associates of the order here, and they agreed not to target Vulcan's officials in exchange for Seki being left as their personal dominion, and unmarked properties upon Armageddon. Vulcan agreed, but it was an uneasy truce. The unmarked towers of the assassins are discreetly spied upon by salamanders and imperial operatives daily, while Seki is a forbidden zone for diplomats and reporters for the Grand Journal, a journalistic mega-project devised by experts of the Gathena system to document the entire history of the Vulcan Imperium. What the Heracles agents are actually up to is known to a scant few people, and will be covered in a later section. A sector spanning human empire known as the Realm of Fathers, this is a rough translation, was encountered by the Vulcan Imperium on its fringes, close to the Ophelion area of influence, but beyond their control. This realm was filled with hundreds upon hundreds of productive, peaceful and efficient worlds, full of quiet, diligent workers and citizens. There was no unrest, and everyone seemed to be happy and content. They rarely even seemed to speak to one another. When Vulcan's armies came, they were welcomed by the court of the regents, and within a few months of their arrival, had signed treaties and pledged oaths in blood and stone. Their factories and produce yards were so very efficient that they had a major surplus of materials, which they traded within the Vulcan Imperium and provided a massive amount of goods to the expanding Imperium. They even paid double the standard tithes asked of them. However, the Realm of Fathers held a terrible secret. For they bore a legacy of ancient corruption in their very blood. They were, to a man, all Genestealer cultists. With the abandonment of the Genestealers by the High Fleet thousands of years ago, the Genestealers had merely continued to do what they were born to do, survive and reproduce. Every other den of Jenna Steelers had been eventually slain over the years by various powers. Yet, one cult had survived. And, surprisingly, without the Hive fleets, the Jenna Steelers were allowed to flourish. Nobody had ever seen how far a Jenna Steeler infestation could develop. Until then, there were hundreds of patriarchs ruling the empire in well-shielded bastions within the main capital worlds of the empire. Every single human was a hybrid to some degree, even if the vast multitude were merely smiling drones, infested at birth with the love of the bulbous beasts that ruled from the depths of their world. Every mind was linked by the fearsome brood telepathy of the Patriarch Prime and his brothers and sons. There was no dissent or hate between the people, for they knew each other as well as they knew themselves, and they all loved the patriarchs. As every mind was linked, they produced mega projects and vast quantities of material with frightening speed. Though no one had ever seen the Prime Patriarch, it is said he swelled to an impossibly vast scale, bloated with psychic power until his magnificent potential made his presence visible to Vulcan himself. If Vulcan had known of the nature of his new ally, he neglected to mention it to his own councils, who only learned of their nature after an accidental shuttle crash had dropped one of their officials into the subterranean feeding pits for the pure streams. There was outrage and furious debate amongst the rulers of the Imperium. The commanderies were in two minds over the matter. Some wished to invade at once, others wanted to wait for Vulcan's decree. Some of the mortal rulers debated over the matter with more nuance. They had become reliant upon the exports and tithes of this new allied territory, for good or ill. Humanity had a long history of hatred for the Xenos, but the Jenna Steeler held no specific dread amongst the councils of Armageddon. Most were too young to remember the Tyranids as anything other than mythical monsters from the primordial times. From their perspective, creatures as far distant and irrelevant as the dinosaur of the long-forgotten home world of Terra. Indeed, there were Carnifex bones in several museums across the central worlds of the Vulcan Imperium. In the end, it was Vulcan that decided what happened next. He arrived unannounced into the council halls of the Tower of Governance upon the rebuilt Hades Palace, flanked by his robed salamander custodians, interrupting a policy meeting of the Grand Lords without a single care. He asked them to show leniency to the cultists. They had never made war upon him, and their industry was required if the Imperium was to face the troubles ahead effectively. Not only this, but a war with the cult would cripple his fledgling Imperium even if they won. The cult had a vast military machine of elite fighters and abundant equipment, supported by legions of pure Strarine shock troops to serve as their Praetorians. Vulcan asked this of his councils, but never made an order. He desperately wanted his mortals to run their own Imperium. He was merely the agent of their survival. The councils agreed. The cultists were to remain upon their worlds. However, they were not to interbreed and subvert any humans in unwilling communities. Every world and every merchant vessel that traded with their realm was required to take genetics screening to detect any possible infections. Additionally, their status as Xenos hybrids was to be suppressed and classified. Normal citizens need not know that aliens supplied much of their products. Indeed, did not Jacaro Smith make many of the esoteric items of the Imperium of old? Why Vulcan championed the cultists remains a contested topic. It was claimed he had foreseen the time of alignment, beginning M55, which threw the galaxy into the greatest conflict in all the eons of galactic history before it, and saw the worth of the cult in this great war. Others claim it was a more personal reason. They claim Vulcan traveled into the heart of the cult sector, and straight to the heart of the Chitin Keep, the throne city of the Patriarch. It is claimed he looked into the golden reptilian eyes of the Patriarch, and confronted it, ignoring the oceans of Jenna Steelers that surrounded him silently. The Patriarch, they say, promised Vulcan a mighty prize in exchange for a union. It claimed, through its Magus proxy, which allowed it to speak as men speak, it had a vision of a world of pulverized stone, and an empty throne, guarded by sullen angels. It had seen some great force sweep in and take the unmoving king. It had witnessed the Obsidian Juggernaut, Vulcan himself, arrive and find the tomb empty. The Patriarch knew what Vulcan so desperately searched for, but could not find. Something the Patriarch alone knew, for it knew who had stolen the Lion of Caliban from his undying slumber. And what was more, the Patriarch knew, with all its psychic might, where he had been taken. espionage and unknown missions. The galaxy in the Age of Dusk was one of great bombastic light, the light granted by great wars, and the glow of towering civilizations rising to their very heights, moments before the precipice. Yet, a bright light casts long shadows. And just as light casts a shadow, so the vast battles and politics of the struggle for reality conceal lingering oceans of events, betrayals and schemes unseen and unrecorded by the histories of man and beast. Until this day, where I was able to breach this vault's walls and I say too much. How this history has come to you, my surviving readers, shall be related in due time. But this section shall cover the hidden missions and events that guided events throughout this time. The Heracles cult continued a secret war against the agents of the Hydra Lords and their infinite familiars and ciphers. But the Order of Assassins Heracles was not solely interested in thwarting the Hydra. They loaned their services as spies and killers to the highest bidders, moving discreetly through human and Xenos societies alike in their desire to achieve their mercenary ambitions. Other assassin cults worshipped the murder god Cain, and spoke forbidden words and performed rituals which they hoped would bring them closer to the eternal kill. These cults were not species-centric. If you could kill one of them, you were worthy of becoming one of them, provided you survived the reprisals. Dark Elder sometimes sponsored such cults, but invariably ended up hunting them for sport within Kamorak once they were bored with them. Yet, there was talk of a dark force, a shadow unseen, which was moving through the disparate fraternity of slayers, be they Heracles bonded killers, freelancers, or even the Melissite stalkers and semi-demonic assassins employed by the Ordo Hydra and the Chaos Imperiums in general. The Grand Lords of the Orders became paranoid, desperate and ever more deadly, for there was naught more dangerous than a cornered assassin. They gathered clues and snippets of information from across the galaxy on news of this killer and where it could be located and destroyed. From the sterile, drug-controlled lobotopias of the TAU Empire's capital septs, to the badlands and feral outlands of trading posts and warp-tainted drinking dens, the agents of the assassins extorted information from contacts by force, murdered and stolen data cores, or otherwise overheard conversations and conspiratorial whispers. All in the hope of finding their elusive predator. The rumors and whispers spoke of a cluster of grim worlds, in the shadow of the ancient star of Tothanus. The rain-racked world of Kolobar was a world of miserable citizens leading pointless, short lives beneath the lash of bureaucracy for all eternity. In the year 883 M53, monsters descended upon Kolobar. Some had arrived years earlier, disguised by chemicals or more paranormal techniques. Others slinked amongst the sewers and rooftop gutters of the Grey Sit Escape, hungry for the blood of their foes. They each came of their own volition. Each supreme killer had followed their own trail of clues and brutally obtained truths. Swiftly and silently, they closed in upon their target. It was known as the Collectioner's Court, the tax offices of Kolobar City. This was where the Dark Force was hiding, and they attacked with fury born of selfishness. The Carapace armored enforcers guarding the lobby were suddenly assailed by blood-drenched beasts with crazed Aversa descendant strains. With a howl and a storm of blades, the assassins butchered the enemy even as they screamed in terror and unloaded magazine after magazine of shotgun and autogun shells into the blood-maddened killers. The place was a charnel house. The windows of the offices high within the taxman's tower splintered as high-velocity rounds punched through them, pitching scribes and clerks from their feet in puffs of blood and vaporized bone. Some office workers turned on their own, blades shuddering into existence in place of their hands, before they slaughtered everyone they could find. Some, bearing serpentine tattoos, pulled hand cannons and bolt guns from their desk drawers, and gunned down their fellows at random. Though the assassins worked individually, the fact these individuals attacked at once meant the tower was swiftly depopulated. After 10 minutes, the tower was full of nothing but corpses. The assassins coldly began to search the offices, for the chamber they all knew was hidden within the labyrinthine complex. They tore the place to shreds, keen eyes glowering as they scanned every document and schematic they could find. Eventually, they found it, a chamber which was not found upon the plans, or marked in any way by the former staff of the Collectioner's Court. They converged upon this prize like a pack of jackals brought together temporarily for a great feast. Melter bombs boiled away the heavy adamantine doors, and the assassins burst into the darkness eagerly. There was darkness there, and little more. darkness and a series of heavy crate sasses. The more prescient assassins instantly leapt from the room, as the bombardment cannon shells in the crates, rigged up to simple proximity fuses, detonated with the thunderclap of titans. The gray skyline of Culliver was illuminated for several long seconds, as the fusion fires boiled away the storm clouds above the tower for miles around. Within the burning crater that was once a hab block, those surviving assassins pulled themselves free of the flaming debris. Skinless and screaming in fury, they noticed the ring of hulking shadows surrounding the crater far too late. Bolters rang out in the night, as the dark armored astarts murdered the assembly of assassins with thoughtless efficiency. Only two figures did not add their weight of fire to the fusillade. Both were hooded. Both were faceless. The first was a giant amongst giants, and bore a mantle of wilting midnight feathers about his vast shoulders. His identity remained a mystery to the wider galaxy until the war fought upon the armored skin of a god, which shall be related to you in due course, once my surviving servitors can traverse this realm. If I could truly call this place a realm. The other figure remained a mystery. We have no information upon him. We only have the whispered intrigues of clerks and scriveners the galaxy over, who speak of a man without fear. A man who, they say, was like water, untrappable, and unstoppable. Within the TAU Empire's tightly controlled society, the Sicker caste of the Imien were used to locate and eliminate subversive elements within their great worlds, using their gifts to probe the minds of all who fell beneath their gaze. They also helped run the re-education centers, and used telepathy to perfect the correct drug cocktails required to crush any ununified thoughts within the TAU and their closest vassals. The Imien were also essential in combating the Deceiver's infiltrator units of modified Necrons, who constantly sought to undermine the war effort of the TAU and their allies, who were still engaged in a vast, desperate war to contain the Nightbringer and his legions of Silver Destroyers. Ammunition factories that supplied specialized Necron slaying rounds to the frontline military units were often singled out for destruction by Necron doppelgangers. Only a Sicker's second sight could reveal the cold stunted souls that writhed beneath the stolen facades worn by the nightmarish creatures. Unbeknownst to the Thexan Alliance, members of their own race began to parley with Necron envoys, each desiring to gain economic or social dominance against their rivals. In particular, a rogue group of Thexan elite that called themselves the Prospectors of Scytha made a terrible pact with the smiling silver fiend known only as Relay. In exchange for Necron immunity, the vile shape-shifting fiends would let Necrons build tomb complexes beneath the surface of almost 100 of their worlds, and would provide the souls necessary to pilot the Necron constructs that would rise from these tombs and bolster the swelling legions of the Deceiver, who had always had the least Necrons under his control, compared to his more powerful brothers. This betrayal was only revealed when the Thexan Alliance began to collapse in M55, after their heartlands were ripped out by Necrons phasing into battle from nearby turncoat worlds. It is thought the Scytha fiends helped prolong the war for millennia, counteracting the sudden appearance of elite orc war hulks in TAU space, who had aided in pushing the Nightbringer's forces back slightly on multiple fronts. During the first half of the Age of Dusk, worlds, at random, were often attacked by bands of towering, howling mutants of twisted flesh and gnarled claws. Sometimes two factions of monsters descended upon them, and proceeded to tear themselves apart alongside the helpless natives. There was no order to these incursions, and no pattern. Random Imperiums and Empires across the galaxy suffered these bizarre terrorist assaults. As it transpired, what was happening was at once horrifying and surprisingly mundane. It was a competition. This was a contest between artists, each as twisted and unthinkably horrifying as each other. One was a perversion of human science and demonic cunning. The other the pinnacle of Xena's perversion. Urien Rakarth and the Coven of the Flesh Tower of Kimorag had built monsters and living flesh sculptures since the fall, and they had become supremely inventive in their creations over these long millennia. Yet, they had a rival who had learned at their withered feet in the Age of Imperium. Fabius Bile and his cabal of degenerates were also makers of monsters and animators of unclean beasts. The two factions developed an obsession to prove they were the most original of flesh smith. Thus, over the years, they unleashed their grotesques and their new men out into reality to test them. Wherever Bile traveled, he was pursued by slavering beasts that sought to protect him, and others to kill him. In turn, he would allow his own creations to be captured in Dark Elder slave raids, and into the hands of the Homunculi, who were often temporarily slain by cunning chaos abominations. Each time an attack failed, the creators would send polite notes to their opposites, explaining why their monsters had failed, and pointers on how to improve their art. This was the correspondence of scholars, delivered by monstrous couriers, who tore apart thousands of innocents over the years. Yet, not every covered action in the Age of Dusk was born of spite and menace. The Councils of the Vulcan Imperium created the Brethren of the Willing. This was a group of adventurers and investigators, founded in M55, to uncover the dark secrets of the galaxy, and figure out a way to defeat them, or to prevent their terrible prophecies coming to pass. Their leader was Imogen Coltrane, a female scholar of stupendous intelligence and matchless bravery. The group she gathered was recruited from many diverse sources across the Imperium. Outcasts and heroes, mercenaries and ideological prodigies. At one time or another, several MKI and MKII starts were known to have joined the Brethren at one point. It was never a big group, and its membership altered several times over the course of history. However, they were clever and brilliant to a man. They worked to save and protect Vulcan's people. They had unofficial sanction from Vulcan, which often meant they had to avoid censure by unwitting local authorities. But this was how Imogen preferred to work. On the seat of my britches mostly, she was quoted as once explaining to a bewildered scribe who attempted to collate her history. They'd discovered much during their time. They helped decipher the various prophecies of the old races. They discovered and fully realized the dark potential of the Necrons and proved the existence of their gods once and for all. They who helped gather the various artifacts scattered across the galaxy. This account can only give a few examples of their many missions, but there were far more, all hidden from the eyes of history by centuries of secrecy and the gulf carved into history by this war which still threatens to engulf us all. But they were as heroic indeed as any of the expeditionary leaders of Vulcan's many armies. Raising the Siege Titan's surface is barren and burnt, and demons crawl across its surface. But the demons never concerned themselves with the surface, which was constantly scoured clean of life by the regular sweeps of the Dragon's Silver Annihilators. No, the demons burrowed and crawled, down and down into the dark catacombs and secret tunnels that perforated the Saturnine moon like a honeycomb. And there they died, in their endless droves. It was there, deep inside, where the psychic screams of ancient heroes reverberated, and where the sonorous ringing of talons against glinting plate filled the air. The Grey Knights and the Custodians still fought, with the tireless courage of doomed men driven beyond extremity by their prolonged test. Purifiers and paladins formed choke points in the narrow tunnels, and they butchered every wave of demons. Century upon century upon century had passed. The armor of Grey Knight and Custodian were indistinguishable. Each was pot-marked, torn and dull. Each warrior was coated in 100 years of gore and bubbling nightmare spores. They had long ago fired their last bolts. Every Sir cannon was spent. Promethium had long since been poured, burning into the faces of veritable tides of demons. Even their power armor had run down, and the energy fields on power weaponry sparked and flared no more. Only the psychic will of the knights remained undiminished by age or the crushing embrace of time. Nemesis weapons still flickered with soul fire, and the psychic counterattacks of the demon hunters persisted. Monsters of every patron came, from juggernauts to winged furies, and more indistinguishable creatures loped from the gloom, pseudopods lashing and beaks scratching. The knights held them off. But they were constricting and contracting. More and more of the valiant superhumans died every year, their armor stripped and blessed, their bodies anointed in ornate rituals, before being used as blocks in flesh ramparts and barriers to prevent demonic outflanking in the narrow warrens of the inner sanctums. Only their psychic might sustained their bodies, and even this and their miraculous genetic form could not sustain them indefinitely. Slowly but surely, they began to fall. Many fell to the ravenous maws of spawn and demons. Others collapsed under the strain of their armor against their ravaged muscles. Others destroyed themselves in psychic implosions, simply to buy time for their brothers to fall back into ever tighter and more dense defensive position. Eventually, a mere 100 were left, led by the ravaged Custodian chief and the Castellan known as Obex. Crow had been lost a decade previously. His malevolent sword, sensing a crack in his resolve, failed him as he clashed with the blubbering morass of a great unclean one. His armor, split and broken, was flooded with entities of the destroyer hive. After a horrifying moment of rigid resistance, his armor fell to the ground, empty. But the knights would not break. They could not break. The names of every one of the million martyrs of Titan were etched into their ceramite and branded upon their skin. After long last, they fell back to the only chamber left unsullied by demon flesh, the vaults themselves, where all the most arcane and forbidden of artifacts were stored. Strange devices and structural masterpieces haunted the pitch-black chambers, and the air was impossibly chill. At the very rear of the vault, the embalmed corpse of the Emperor sat, perched upon an obsidian throne, threaded with green-veined marble. While they still lived, the memory of his existence and his works would forever be preserved, and he could never truly die. They cared not what his deformed godhead had become in the warp. They were not ignorant, however. They had felt his ascension just as the astropaths had. But they were not duped by the Starfather's apotheosis. The knights and the custodes knew what the Emperor was. He was no god of the warp. He was champion of humanity, champion of mankind's dominion over the real, over the sane. The Starfather was a distortion, a monster born in the minds of the deluded and the weak-willed. Not like the true heroes of the dead Imperium, for the true heroes knew that the creed was merely the rallying cry of all of man, and could not be undone by the removal of the greatest man amongst them. No man, no matter how great, could match the collective resolve of humanity united. The Starfather was a disgusting parody of this, a reciprocal entity which devoured its own worship, and created itself. He was not worthy. And so they fought on. A Bax strode out into the arming hall before the chamber's doors, flanked by the last two functioning dreadnoughts, Alaric and Tancred, to face the onrushing horde, which had swelled to an ever greater size, for the demons knew the end would be coming soon. The rest of the knights followed them out, but just as 10 of them marched out to join their liege, Lord Abax turned and uttered the command terminus. The vault doors sealed, and the majority of his knights were sealed within, leaving but a token force to hold the great hallway before Titan's final vault. The custodian screamed and yelled down his vox, pleading with his millennial friend and brother to open the doors, to let him aid in driving back the demons. Together, we may face our glorious doom together, the custodian declared in a fierce yet mournful voice. Abax's reply was brief. The tarot has been set, but the last cards are yet to be dealt. Stay by the Emperor's side, custodian, as you were ever destined to. With that, the vox link was finally severed, and Abax charged into the ravening mass of tendrils and oozing flesh that greeted him. His broken sword was raised, and he screamed the 666 litanies of hate as he fought. The dreadnoughts followed suit, smashing apart demons with their claws and even with the barrels of spent assault cannons and plasma guns. Blades flashed and demons died. Oceans of corrosive sludge pumped from severed heads and bisected maws. It was then that Tancred was hacked in twain by the black blade of a most dreadful of demons. Imkar itself capered into the fray, at the head of the horde of horrors. The dreadnought Alaric was the first to notice his foe of long years past, and he instantly clashed with the demon prince's smoking blade. The two giants wrestled as the others fought with all their hearts and all their souls. They wielded their hate as shafts of searing faith, drenched in gore but cackling all the same. They were wild in their frenzy. But, it was to no avail. Alaric banished Imkar, but standing over his disintegrating form was no victory. The demon thing laughed even as it was wrenched from reality. Your time has ended. Your end was determined long before you were created. It has hissed as the demon perished. Soon after, Alaric fell, dragged down by thousands upon thousands of furies that wriggled through the constricted tunnels like maggots. The tides of damnation flowed over the tarnished knights and nothing could prevent what came next. The custodian listened through the 6 meters of adamantium separating him from the combat. He heard them all perish, one by one, defiant screams replaced by gurgling laughter spat out of inhuman jaws. Then, the mockery turned to a sinister murmur, as the demons turned to the task of opening the vault. Boom after boom resonated through the door. The remaining defenders merely listened to the sounds with downcast helms, sitting amongst the antique items which had never been used, nor could be used. They sat awaiting their fate in a veritable museum of their own history, their own purpose. It was then, as even the resolve of the greatest collective wills in the galaxy faltered, that something changed, and a sound which had not been heard for a very long time upon Titan roused them from their misery. Bolt of fire. Masses of concentrated bolt of fire came from beyond the vault door. Now it was the demon's turns to scream. The custodian located the few remaining Tech Marines and demanded to know what was happening beyond the door. Eventually, the Astartes and Custodes managed to rig up a makeshift picto feed to a dead pict servitor out in the hallway. What they saw confused them, for their reinforcements were Astartes clad in flaming black armor and helms that were the shape of grinning chaplain death masks. They were the Legion of the Damned. A myth no longer. They killed the demons in their droves, each silent as the grave as they killed. So rapt were the knights that only the custodian himself noticed that one of the ancient artifacts in the vault was reactivating. It was one of the ancient portals of the Elder, and it began to shudder into life. As it grew in power and glowed with newfound vigor, the knights and custodians turned to face this new apparition. Had they not faced enough foes now, what was this new devilry? These questions plagued their war-ravaged minds as the portal, with the final lyrical crescendo, activated. Out stepped two little girls. They wore their hair in pigtails, and their simple cream robes were the mirror of one another, as they walked from the webway gate hand in hand. Their power was instantly unmistakable. Every knight in the room involuntarily shivered at their psychic presence. It was rare to be in such close proximity to one apex level Sicker, let alone two. The girls smiled at the assembled giants that surrounded them. One of the knights managed to bite back his delirious sense of awe and spoke first. "Why have you come?" was all he could manage. "We opened the doorway which only we can open, to make Uncle happy with us. You must all come along with us now. Uncle is ever so friendly, but he needs all his pieces if we are to play his game. We so like his games. Come along. The mad one will wake soon. That's when it'll start. We don't want to miss it," they replied cheerfully, in unison. "The fact I am aware of this story at all should suggest to you that the knights and their allies took up the diminutive apex twins up on their enigmatic request, and at least survived long enough to tell other souls, other chroniclers of their deeds. So it came to pass that Titan was relieved, and the body of the Emperor was snatched from the jaws of heretical defilement." Ha, heresy. Such an odd word to use now. Now that I know what is coming. So I've recently moved Nickbeardia merch over to Teespring and have a few new designs. Listings are below the video and in the description.
Just stop! Just stop it! Stop! No! Just stop it! It's time to stop! It's time to stop, okay? No more! Where the fuck are your parents? Who are your parents? I'm gonna call Child Protective Services.